I'm sharing the screen with the particular software. I have few slides over there. All right, can you guys see the slides, foundations in Alexity?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So let's move on.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, so.
Yes, sir.
Got it, guys. Yeah. Now, let's see what topics are there and how we'll be addressing. Before any topic, we have to give respect to the people who worked on it, really worked on it and gave these theories. So that's why I gave the starting thing as historical perspective or a Alexity perspective. Then we move on to the textbook syllabus where we speak about Drudon-Lorentz theory. It's part of your textbook syllabus. Electric current, the definition. When I say energy perspective, it means we'll be talking about electromotive force and potential difference. EMF and potential difference, they correspond to work done or energy. Work done is generally equivalent to energy. They're not equal to each other, but they're equivalent to each other. Okay. That's where the theory ends. Somewhere in between, I'll also be pulling out the working of a battery, what happens inside the battery. And after that, it's all experiments. When we talk about Ohm's law with an iron wire and an LED, it's an experiment. Then there are four factors that affect resistance, if you remember. So one of the factors is the length of the wire or length of the conductor. Another factor is the cross-sectional area, like how thick it should be, how thin it should be. That's what is a cross-sectional area. Another factor is the material itself. Is silver a better conductor? Is iron a better conductor? We are talking about the material property. And the last one is the temperature. Which is the best conductor? A copper wire at room temperature or a copper wire at 200 degrees centigrade? So all those things we'll be addressing. Those all we'll be doing with experiments. We'll be working with experiments. Then after that, we have series and parallel circuits. That's also a couple of experiments. We'll be proving the loss. R is equal to R1 plus R2 plus R3 for series. And 1 by R is equal to 1 by R1, so on for parallel. And before we conclude our session, we'll be talking about Kirchhoff's loop law and junction law. So junction law is also called the law of conservation of charge with respect to the electricity topic. And loop law is the law of conservation of energy. Okay. So let's look into the historical perspective. When I say history, I'm not talking about really, really Stone Age history. I'm talking about somewhere around 2000 BC or 3000 BC, something like that. So at that time, I would not say people were into research. They were more curious. They saw a lot of things. They observed a lot of things. And they were very, very curious. They were trying to understand what's happening. But unfortunately, they did not have the basis. We have a basis to analyze. We have like thousands of years of science that was developed not only in the West, but also in the East, like India, China, and all those countries. Okay, so with all this information, we have a good understanding of science, but we are talking about 2000 or 3000 years back. So some of the things that really created curiosity in terms of electricity topic is one of them is the electric eel. I hope you can see the electric eel. So it's kind of a fish, a long fish actually. The special thing about an electric eel is whenever you are near an electric eel, I mean, if you are standing in a pond that has full of electric eels, you would be jolted with close to 20,000 volts of voltage. I mean, it's you know the difference between voltage and current, I hope. But when we go to the future slides and all, we'll be working with those. So when someone is near an electric eel, what this eel does is with its bioelectrical mechanisms, it produces or it sends out high voltage of current. The current will be less, but the voltage is enormous. And the purpose of that is fight or flight mechanism. Animals do that. We also do that. We have an option of fight, flight, or analyze. Animals have the option of only fight or flight. So in order to get a prey, in order to obtain its own food, it either gives that volts of energy or in order to escape from a predator. Imagine there's a shark around. In order to escape from that shark or a much bigger fish, it sends out that electrical energy. So people saw these electric eels. and they wanted to find out what's happening. They had no clue, by the way. They just were amazed by it. And you can also see another one example over here is the lodestone, L-O-A-D, load. Okay, lodestone, it's actually magnetite. So you might have seen your sixth class textbooks long back, right? So one of the things that happened was ancient Egypt and all, they found these special stones, and these stones were able to attract iron particles. They used to find such stones near volcanoes, actually. Okay, so it's called lodestone, a black color stone. It's made up of magnetite. And then you have a third example of both. I mean, you might be wondering what this cute cat is doing here. Yes, definitely. I just got a question from Amrit. He said 20,000 words. So does arcing happen? Arc, generally you see when the water, I mean, let's talk about thunder and rainstorms. Why do you see that giant arc right from the top, from the sky towards earth? Because the air in between is not really a good conductor of electricity. So since it's not a good conductor of electricity, you see that thunderstorm, like the lightning arc, and also you see all the heat formation. But if you are actually in the presence of a good conductor, like seawater, then you might not see arc. Our human body suffers during a shock because our body is made up of material that's not very conductive, not electrically conductive. So in order to compensate, that electricity or electrons, when they move in our body during an electric shock, they just burn everything in the process. But in seawater, you might not see electric arc. The reason is seawater is extremely conductive and it's huge amount of water. But if it is in a pond like drinking water with very few minerals, then there is a possibility of seeing an arc. Okay. Exactly. Air gets ionized. Amrit already answered the question for me. Right. So let's move on. The third example over here is a very cute cat with an amber stone. This kind of golden color thing is an amber stone. So what people observe, not essentially cat, but any other like hairy substance. Excuse me. When an amber stone is rubbed with the fur of a cat, or even fur of a rabbit, or even your hair is essentially one sort of fur. So when you rub the amber stone, what happens is it starts to attract small pieces of husk or small pieces of paper. So people were curious about that. Suddenly, how did this particular amber stone get this property of attracting property? Okay. So I talked about three phenomena that created huge amount of curiosity. One is an electric eel. It gives out that electric shock wave inside water, but not outside, obviously, because it's very hard to ionize. Okay. Second one is a lodestone magnetite, which actually attracts a lot of iron particles. And third one, a seemingly useless amber stone, which is of course very good to look at, that almost useless amber stone starts to attract small pieces of paper or wheat husk when it is rubbed with the fur of a cat or fur of any animal. So these were the curiosities. And many people thought all of them belong to the same phenomenon. Everyone thought these three are not separate phenomenon. They're all the same. And William Gilbert, this is one of the scientists in almost like, I think 1400s, a little before Isaac Newton. So what he proposed was, he wrote a book. And this book is very, very famous. The reason was, it's not like groundbreaking results or magical results. It's only one of the first books ever written on this topic. Okay, whatever electricity, whatever magnetism you study, all these happened only, the Western philosophy or Western mindset, it only happened in the last 200 days. And one of the first people who wrote this concept was William Gilbert in his book, The Magnetic. So you can search in Google and you can get a free book and make sure you look for an English version, not Latin version or something. Okay, so what he said was, for the first time, he categorically he told that the phenomenon behind magnetite, the way it is attracting iron particles, and the phenomenon behind electric eel or the cat's fur and amber are quite different. So he said that there are two things happening. One is something related to magnetism. Another one is completely different. It's related to electricity or charges, something related to charges. So I hope you got my point. So why is this important? Because in order to go in depth into any topic, you need to be strong with your fundamentals. So in order to have the fundamentals, you need to understand how those people at that time, with all their superstitions or with all their awareness and wisdom, how they handled the material or the how they handled the observations in their daily life. If you could grasp that, then you can have your own theory built in the future maybe. Okay. So William Gilbert's contribution is one thing. He separated electricity and magnetism. He categorized some attractions are because of electricity and some attractions are because of magnetism. Then I actually moved way forward, actually, even before Benjamin Franklin. I hope you know who Benjamin Franklin is. So he was one of the American revolutionaries against the British monopoly that was happening in the in US. And not only that, he was a politician, he was a public speaker, was a philosopher too. He did a lot of things. He was even good with chemistry, if I'm not wrong. So Benjamin Franklin's experiments with electricity was a huge boost to this topic. So before Benjamin Franklin, people knew this electricity and all, but they did not have a lot of theories about it, or they did not understand what was happening in the real world. So he actually gave a lot of things. And because of his input, people thought that, okay, such a great guy is doing all this. We also do some research, and they push the field a lot. But before I speak to you about Benjamin Franklin, I want to talk to you about Maxwell. He's considered, if you talk about the greatest people in science ever and ever, some of the people that would come to your mind is Archimedes, way before Christ, 2000 BC or something. And then comes the Newton, Sir Isaac Newton. Yes, let me complete this, Amarnath, and I'll check out what the question is. So I'm talking about the greatest people who contributed to science or to technology. One is Archimedes. Of course, these are personal opinions. Then comes Sir Isaac Newton, who you know about. And then comes Einstein. And I would not talk about Niels Bohr as a revolutionary, but Niels Bohr's concept of quantum mechanics, quantum mechanical model, is again enormous. So three people I already spoke, but one person we generally overlook is Maxwell. Okay, I'm not talking about the cricketer Maxwell. He is physicist Maxwell, somewhere between Einstein and Newton. So his contribution to society is whatever William Gilbert said, that electricity and magnetism is different. He actually combined them, and they said, and what he said was, electricity and magnetism, both are single phenomenon. It comes under a field called electromagnetism. So William Gilbert separated them. Maxwell, he brought mathematics for the first time into this concept, and he joined electricity and magnetism and brought in the concept of electromagnetism and also electromagnetic induction. Okay, so I spoke about four greatest scientists in my opinion. So let's look at it. Amarnath just gave me a message saying that even plastic roller attracts paper when rubbed with hair. Exactly. Not only that, there are a lot of other things that could attract. I mean, you in your seventh class, you have an experiment about electrostatics where you are asked to blow a balloon, rub it with a paper, and bring it close to tiny pieces of paper, very, very small pieces of paper. So even that is an experiment, very similar experiment. All of that comes under electrostatics. It's part of electromagnetism or current electricity, actually. Amarnath, is it answered or do you want to speak about it? Okay, let me unmute. You guys can unmute yourself if you want to say anything. So before we move on, I am open for questions, whatever we spoke till now. If you have any questions, please ask me and then we can move on. Please be free. Don't hesitate. You can speak whatever you want. No good question, no bad question. No one is going to laugh at your questions. Everything is educational, guys. Anyone with questions? You can speak up. You don't have to chat if you want. At least for now, you can speak up. All right. no questions. I hope you are listening and not sleeping, right? Okay, so let's move on. Now we have we spoke about the next person, but I want to speak about Benjamin Franklin's experiments. You know, right, the specs, the glasses that I'm wearing, that's his invention also. I mean, Benjamin Franklin invented them. He was an innovator, amazing guy. So what he did, or people say he did not actually do it. He only proposed the idea. Someone else did it for him. I mean, like his assistants. So whatever it is, it's his experiment in a way. So you can observe this small copper wire, a very thin copper wire. And this copper wire is attached to a kite. So on a very stormy day or stormy night, Benjamin Franklin supposedly, he actually sent out a kite, the kite that we actually played with. So that such a kite with a copper wire instead of a thread. So when this kite moves on to the ionized air, very close to the clouds and all that, so this particular copper could carry out, could actually transfer all that electricity to the ground. And this particular copper wire is actually connected to the ground, so no harm will be done to the person actually holding. And in fact, he's holding a key. As you can observe, there's a key over here. And this is only an imaginary description of a painter. We really don't know if he did it in such a way, and it's not advisable. Such a high, like the electric eel, even the thunderstorms give out close to 20,000 volts. That's dangerous. I mean, people die because of this lightning shocks, actually. Okay, so the importance of this experiment is simple. The natural phenomenon that happens in the sky, that's based on electricity. That's what he concluded. And it can be harnessed and it can be a useful energy. That's what Benjamin Franklin told. So before Benjamin Franklin understood this or explained this, people thought, as usual, that everything is based on gods. And by the way, guys, girls, I'm not trying to diminish old ideas or old philosophies about gods, but we also have to understand the science that is there. I mean, there's a thin line between superstition and science. And it's also our responsibility to not consider everything that a religion gives as superstition. Okay? Whatever religion tells, some people consider them as superstition. No, not really. Those traditions that were established by religion, at least some of them or many of them, the purpose of them was simple. Everyone was illiterate, more or less. Very few people got a chance to go to Gurukulas and get educated under great masters. But most of the people in the ancient world were illiterates. So they need to hear good things. And the only way the great gurus thought that general people could understand and could implement is by bringing God into the picture. So very good things or very good ideas, they spread it to the masses using God as a medium. So those are all wonderful things. But nowadays the people or scientists or everyone, they try to say that everything is trash, God doesn't exist and all. So that's a huge debate and all. I don't want to get into that. But as people or people of science, you're also people of science. So I want you to keep your mind open. Use your critical thinking before you could consider something as superstition or not. So have an open mind before you completely ignore something, okay? And imagine if people would have thought that anything that you can't see is not real, then you have no theory related electromagnetism, magnetic fields, force fields, all these you can't see, you only can experience. So same thing goes with many things actually. So don't just ignore something. I want you to keep an open mind as people of science. All right. So that's Benjamin Franklin's contribution. Now let's move a little bit forward. Benjamin Franklin did it in 1770s or something like that. And after that, we are moving to the 1800s. So one of the biggest things that happened was because of Galvani. Okay. Galvani, the left one, not the right one, guys. Right one is a cell that was created by Volta. It's called a Volta cell. I'll speak about it. But before I go on, I want to find out. Yes, Amrit, do you have something? Please go ahead and speak, Nana. All right, so Amrit has this. Many people say that we can't store the lightning, but we do. Why don't we store the charge in ultra capacitors. That has been, I mean, let me explain Amrit's question to you. What Amrit was saying is, what is the problem in storing? Right now, we just said it's enormous amount of energy, the lightning strikes and all, and it happens everywhere in the world. What is the problem in storing energy? And also, he gave a suggestion, Amrit gave a suggestion in using capacitors. And in fact, the specific type of capacitors, he was talking about ultra capacitors. So the problem even till date is we don't have good batteries to store the energy. That has been the huge problem for the entire world. Are you aware that, right now, you know, the current energy revolution, right? Everyone is trying to push in solar energy, wind energy and all. And in US, there is one great guy who might become the next Archimedes. His name is Elon Musk. I want you to read about him. Elon Musk. He's a Canadian person, but he stays in US. He lives in US. He owns multiple companies. One of the companies is Tesla, T-E-S-L-A. It's named after Nikola Tesla, one of the greatest, people in electricity, like Edison. Nikola Tesla is another great guy. So the company name is Tesla. So he created these electric cars. And the problem or the thing about electric cars is he's not the first guy to make an electric car. Even before the cars that we use today is fossil fuel based cars, right? Like the petrol, diesel based cars. All before these cars arrived, electric cars were also made. I mean, almost at the same time, just before Ford, the Michael Ford, the first guy to make a car, even before him, electric car was made. But the problem was there's no good method to store that charge. Even till date, even today, we don't have really good batteries. But because of Elon Musk and the Tesla company, we are getting some new batteries that could store energy. And the problem with that electric current or the lightning strike is 20,000 volts in a millisecond. Imagine how good your battery should be to store that energy or accept such an amount of energy in millisecond of time. We don't have the technology. That's the problem. You make such a battery, you will be the next Nobel Prize winner. Okay? And when you get the Nobel Prize, please mention Amir sir's name and my name. My name is Bhanu Prakash, by the way. Okay? Right. So that's the problem. So even with ultra capacitors, the problem with capacitors is it could store energy, and even their design is not perfect enough. They drain their energy slowly or lately. They do that. So even with the latest capacitors, the same problem is continuing. But our world is going in a good direction in making amazing batteries. A lot of research is happening. And that's the technology of the future. But it's even required in the present. One of the reasons solar energy has failed till now, even the governments are pushing very hard to use solar energy, is because of lack of good batteries. So that's a huge market requirement. And the projects that you do for Inspire and all those, I want you to think about these, the battery technology. It's a good research study too, guys. Okay? When I say research, don't think only PhDs should do it. Anyone could do it. All you need is a very good internet connection and a person who could help you when you get stuck. Okay? Right. So let's move on to this particular thing. Galvani and Volta. We have been spending a lot. It's already 2:45. And I also wanted to apologize. I'm sorry. Like, there was a little bit of communication gap about Zoom meeting. So because of that communication gap, we lost 10 valuable minutes. It's okay. I mean, now we understood. And next time, we'll start at time. Okay? Yeah. And I'll try to move a little faster with the history. So this is Galvani's work. So what Galvani did was, by the way, are you familiar with Frankenstein monsters? Okay, there is something called Frankenstein monster. It's not a real monster. It's a fiction story where there is an imaginary monster. So one particular crazy scientist, what he did was he connected human body parts of 100 people or something. One guy's liver, one guy's leg, one guy's head, all the dead bodies he collected. He actually made a human body with that particular thing. He gave certain type of electric shock to it. And suddenly that particular person woke up. Okay, so that's a fiction. It's called Frankenstein monster. And the fictional doctor's name was Frankenstein. So that particular concept arrived because of Galvani's experiment. So this is Galvani and his experiment. What he observed in early 1800s was, you can see frog. I mean, this particular thing is a frog. And what he did was, he made an incision, he made a cut. And you can see this particular metallic wire, as you can see over here. This is a wire, metallic wire. And he connected metallic wire at two parts, one at this particular location and another one is at this particular location. And as soon as he did this, this particular frog, of course, it's not alive. It's, you can see it's actually cut in half. Okay, its head is missing. So it's not alive, definitely. So this particular frog kind of jerked. That means it kind of kicked its legs. So observing this, what Galvani proposed, he said that animals, even as humans, he said that he gave a theory. He said that we have something called electric fluid in our body. That particular electric fluid is responsible for this kicking action of the frog. And this electric fluid is responsible for transferring all the messages. So when I hit my hand, it's telling, my brain is telling me, crazy guy, stop hitting yourself. So that particular thing is happening because of all the messaging that's happening from my hand to the brain. So all that is because of an imaginary fluid called electric fluid. That's what Galvani said. Okay, that's a theory. You also can give crazy ideas or ordinary ideas, but you should be able to prove it. So when Galvani said this, it became very popular. And Volta heard this. Volta, he actually heard this particular thing and he felt that's not a good idea. There's something problem with this particular idea. And he decided to disprove this particular Galvani's theory. So he made the first battery. Volta created the first battery. That particular thing you can see over here on the right is the Volta battery. So what he created was, there are a lot of plates over here, as you can see. Let's focus only on the top two. I'll try to zoom a little bit. Okay, the quality of the image will be lost, but spare it. Okay, now these are actually a lot of Volta cells. And this total thing is actually called a Volta cell. But I want you to focus, let's say, the top two. The top two are made with different metals, actually. Different metals. And in between these top two plates, in between, he kept papers that are soaked in salt water. Once again, listen carefully. There are two different metallic plates, the top plate and the bottom plate. Over here, there are two plates. In between the plates, there's a paper that is soaked in salt water. And such arrangements, the 2+1 arrangement, he repeated, and all of these are such plates, actually. So the top of all these plates is connected to one end, and the bottom of this another thing is connected to another end. And when you connect these two ends to a bulb or something, the bulb would glow. So this is the first battery ever made. Okay, it's called a Volta cell or a Volta battery. So what Volta proposed is, whatever happening inside the frog, it's very similar to the battery. So your battery had two metallic plates, top plate and the bottom plate. Similarly, there's a top plate over here because of this wire and a bottom plate over here at the leg of the frog. And Volta created a salt paper. I mean, we can call it salt paper if you don't mind. Paper that is soaked with salt water, right? I'm calling it salt paper. That particular salt water or salt paper is replaced by our liquid. Our body is filled with a lot of water, right? And water and a lot of minerals. We consume a lot of minerals, actually, with our curries or with our mineral water, whatever. All those correspond to salt water. So essentially, because of connecting two metals and having a liquid in between, you're making a battery out of it, and that jerking action is because of this battery action. So that is what Volta proved, and with that, the electricity topic bombasted. It blasted out, and many people started using such batteries and started analyzing all the concepts that you have in your textbook right now. Okay, so I had a question, I think. Let me check that particular one. Right, so I think I have few of them. I missed out some of them. Yeah, SpaceX. I spoke about Elon Musk, right? I hope you are having a book with you so that you can write some of the points. ELONMUSK, Elon Musk. Okay, so Elon Musk created Tesla, the company which is making electric cars. He also is the owner of SpaceX. The amazing part of SpaceX is, whenever you think about space travel, rockets and all, the satellites, the first thing that used to come in your mind is NASA. Now we have ISRO. ISRO is doing amazing work, but originally people used to think about NASA. But the amazing part about SpaceX is SpaceX, they actually sell rockets to NASA. They're so good that they're able to launch, they're helping NASA give out rockets actually, or helping NASA with rockets. And SpaceX is the first company which brought in the concept of reusing rockets. So, you know, satellites stand on rockets. So rocket is launched, rocket goes to the Earth's orbit, satellite gets separated, and rocket falls back into the ocean and it never gets used. But what Elon Musk did was, he made sure that rocket doesn't drop randomly in some particular ocean. He made it back to the rocket launching station. So it goes up, leaves the satellite, and comes back carefully back to that particular station. So he could reuse these rockets. So that's an amazing, simple idea, but he was able to do it actually. So, and also have Amrit saying real life Iron Man. Yeah, Iron Man is too much of a crazy idea, but he's close there. Maybe we all can be the real life Iron Man, making all those cool gadgets actually. Yeah, cars and all. Some have Samrat. I hope I'm pronouncing it properly. It spoke about Tesla cars, I guess. Okay, then I have Harshita. Sir, he performed experiment on frog. Then how can he say that electric fluid is present in human body? Yeah, I mean, in a way, we are all animals, right? If you believe evolution theory by, I mean, who gave evolution theory? Some of my memory is suddenly, it's like, yeah.
Darwin.
Darwin, exactly. Charles Darwin. We all came from a single animal. We started out from a fish. And then some of the fishes, they were fed up with water. They came to the ground. Some of them became frogs, so on, so forth and all. So we all are animals. So just like frog, and just the way frog responds, we also respond actually. So that's why he gave that particular thing. Harshita, I think. Yeah, Harshita. And then Amrit has one more pioneering. Yeah, that's what I was saying. I'm sorry, I did not see that. Yeah, reverse landing rockets, reusable rockets. And Hasini, sir, do we need an external wire? Isn't it internally connected? I think, Hasini, I'm hoping you're talking about the frog experiment still. You need to connect it externally too. I mean, even with this Volta cell, if you observe, this particular Volta cell, there is internal wiring. The internal wiring is because of the salt water. External wiring is because of this real copper wires. There are two copper wires here. Similarly, there are copper wires even in galvanized experiment. You need to close the circuit. Circuits cannot be open if you want to supply energy or if you want to move energy around. So you need to close the circuit. So the circuit here is the particular salt solution inside our human body. That's the internal circuit or part of the internal circuit. And the external thing is these wires. Okay? Right. Yeah. So that's about galvani and Volta. And I think this is our last historical lesson. I already spoke about Maxwell. I did not put Maxwell here. I generally speak more about Maxwell in our electromagnetism topic. And by the way, I think electromagnetism will not be in your exams, right? So it's up to you guys and Amir sir, if you want to even experience those experiments. But our focus will be right now in Alexity. At the time of completion of Alexity, I'm sorry, we can discuss if you want to do electromagnetism or if you want to see electromagnetism experiments also. And I want to revise something. I want your idea about your opinion about it. I will clarify this with Amir sir also. I told you that I need 6 hours, but at the pace that we are going and at the interest level some of you are showing, I think 6 hours is not enough. We might have to exceed it. I'm open to it. I'm always ready if someone is ready to listen. If you guys are ready to listen, we can even extend. Instead of 3 days, we can have 4 days. And if you think 2 hours is a lot in a single day, we can even split it up and have more number of days. But I want you to enjoy this, guys. And if you are going to be in science fields, could be MBBS, could be scientists, or it could be doctors or any other science-related field, this is extremely crucial. Maybe some of you want to do PhD in physics. You cannot go in depth into physics without understanding electricity topic, right? So that's the reason I want to focus. And it all depends on you all. If you want me to do it in the same speed and not skip out anything, we need more than 6 hours. So all I want you to do is, I want you to tell Amir sir, if you want more hours, or if the decision is made for 6 hours, then we'll have to speed up a little bit, okay? Anyway, now let's move on. I don't have any questions or anything, so we are moving on. History-wise, the last topic I picked is the left person is Edison. You know, one of his greatest things, the lot of things, but he's more famous for the bulb, electric bulb. And you have Nikola Tesla here. Okay, that's Nikola Tesla. He's also the greatest, one of the greatest people in the field. So the reason I brought this one is, one of the latest revolutions that happened was the fight between DC and AC. DC is the direct current, AC is the alternating current, okay? AC is the alternating, DC is the direct current. And Edison was the proponent of DC. All the machines that he created, or most of the machines that he created, they worked on DC. In fact, I could say that everything he created was made with DC, okay? Even the DC, he created some of the DC motors also. And Nikola Tesla, he promoted alternating current. He actually designed and manufactured alternating current generators, okay? So he promoted AC, okay? So the reason I brought this particular one was, I hope you're familiar with Niagara Falls, one of the biggest waterfalls in the world, not the biggest, but one of the biggest. So the thing about Niagara Falls is, if used properly, the entire west coast of US, United States, right from New York until the bottommost Florida also, right from New York to Florida, you can actually supply electric current to each and every house if you use Niagara Falls properly. That means when water falls, if you could embrace generator rotors, water hits the rotors and electricity could be generated. So when the proposal was there, I mean, Niagara Falls authorities, they were really confused to give a contract to Edison or to Nikola Tesla. If given to Edison, he would have created DC wiring. The entire wires right from the power station to our homes would have been the direct current. So, but in fact, the order was actually obtained to Nikola Tesla, not him directly, but the concept of alternating current. And because of that, our homes actually get alternating current. We don't get direct current, we actually get alternating current. Alternating current is way better than direct current because alternating current results in less energy losses. Energy can be minimized with the help of transformers, actually. So because of that, alternating current is much more useful. And end of the day, when current enters into our house, it could be our fans, it could be whatever motors you use, even televisions, they all use DC current. So because of that, what happens is that you need to have a conversion between AC and DC. It's called AC-DC converters. So anyway, I want to summarize this discussion. Leaving the scientists' names and all these people's names aside. So at the power station, what happens is an alternating current generator is installed. That particular generator creates alternating current, and the alternating current that's generally created over there is enormous, lot of voltage. Again, 10,000 volts, 30,000 volts of voltage will be there. And at the power stations, you have approximately 100 volts or 200 volts, but current will be enormous. 50 amperes, 100 amperes of current will be there. Low voltage, high current will be there at the power stations. So what they do is they establish a transformer over there and they reverse it. So they make the 200 volts to 20 volts, 200 volts to 20,000 volts, and they decrease current from 50 amperes to 0.05 amperes or whatever it is. So they make the voltage high and current small, and they transfer that energy to our houses. Right before it enters into our house, if you go outside and see the street, in your street, if you observe, there'll be another transformer. In that transformer, it will be reversed. From 20,000 volts, it will be changed to 220 volts, and 0.05 amperes or whatever, it changes to higher amperes, okay? So the voltage will be increased again. So it's all this reversal happens. And all this happened because of Nikola Tesla's alternating current generators. Okay. So with that, I want to stop all this history. And I hope you understood the reason for bringing or using 1 hour of your valuable time. People say all the study that we are doing is because of the work of all these Jains. We are sitting on the shoulders of these Jains and we are seeing the world. So you need to understand what work they have done in order to understand what work we would like to do. Okay. So with that, we'll be stopping with history and we'll be moving on to the topics in our textbook. Okay. And before that, I have a couple of chat windows set up. Okay. Right. I have Amarnath saying that I'm a little bit fast. Yes, I'll slow down. I have a tendency of running once in a while. Thank you for reminding me. I'll do that. And also Amrit pointed out the way of converting AC-DC. It's rectifiers, the things called half bridge and full bridge rectifiers. And they use capacitors and all that along with diodes actually. Yes, that's the concept. Very good, Amrit and Amarnath. Yes, I'll slow down. Yeah, keep reminding me once in a while if you think that I'm running away from all this. Okay. Now, before we move on to the actual topic, that's the Drude and Lorentz theory, I want you to take a break of, let's say, 5 minutes. It's 3:04 right now. We'll take 5 minutes break. Let's come back at 3:10. And 3:10 to 4:15, we'll spend and we'll call it off for today. Okay? Is that okay, guys? Just have a break. I mean, drink water, whatever. But come back exactly at 3:10. Okay? I want you to come with fresh mind because this is what is in your textbook. All right, let's move on. Yeah, I'll stay here. I have everything required for me here. You can move on and come back as soon as possible. I'll be speaking at 3:10, guys. Guys, it's 3:10 right now, so let's give a minute more in case some are traveling or en route. So I had a question during the break time. I was asked like how you guys will be like doing the experiments right now. I mean, you were told that this will be a practical session. Unfortunately, the thing is, I will be doing the experiments and you'll be observing. So I'll try my best to keep it as elaborate as possible so that you can have that experience. But what I could promise is when the schools start and the schools reopen, hopefully before before you leave your school after your 10th class, I'm just guessing by March, some things would be proper. And if in case the schools open and if you guys are back at your schools, then what I could tell is based on my confidence with Abir sir and all, I'll speak to Amir sir. And if everything goes proper, I'll come to your school with all the apparatus and you can do the experiments. You are observing right now, but then you will be able to do that. Okay. So it's a compromise. I'll try my best to do it slow and clear. And now we have an opportunity for you to see those apparatus, some of them. So this particular board, I call it the electric board. So with this board, you can do almost all the experiments of a 10th class, 6th class, 7th class, anything related to electricity, you can do it. We'll be spending a lot of time on this board. And there are a few other boards actually. So another board I have is for electricity, for series and parallel. Don't worry about it much. I'm just showing you. This particular board is for Kirchhoff's junction law. And there's one more board. I'll get it for tomorrow's class. It's for Kirchhoff's loop law. Okay. Everything related to electricity we can do with these boards. I'll be, as I told, it will be a demonstration session and hopefully a hands-on workshop in the future. All right. Right. So I hope everyone is back. right? So let's move on. And we were able to start with a textbook theory, and it starts with the Drood and Lorenz theory. Okay. Actually, before we talk about this theory, there is actually a very small experiment in your textbook. So what they ask is, if you have a battery lying around, let me show that experiment. Give me a second. I don't need a lot of changes, but give me a second, guys. All right, so I have a battery here. It's a 9-volt battery. I think you are all used to saying HW battery or something like that, but it's a 9-volt battery, okay? So it has this positive terminal and negative terminal. The hexagonal nut shaped is the negative, and the circular one is the positive, okay? Let me stop this share so you can see in a full screen. All right, so I have two metal wires over here. I'll use a red wire to connect it to the battery positive. So that's the battery positive. I'm connecting a red wire to here. Guys, can you see me in a full screen mode, or is it just a small screen? All I could see is Manideep's window.
Sir, we can see you.
Okay, wonderful. Yeah, you can see me, but is it in a full screen thing?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Niyati. Right, so that's the battery positive. It's just a tiny experiment. Don't get too excited with this. And I'm connecting the battery black, okay, battery black or battery negative with the black wire, right? The next thing I'll do is, you can observe here. So I have a couple of filament bulbs over here, right? And I have 4 LED bulbs at these corners. So this is an unplanned experiment, but since I saw you guys are really interested in everything, I thought of doing this one also. I'm just directly connecting battery. I'm not using any switch right now. So I'm placing my battery down. Okay, I'll just bend it down. I hope you can see the battery. So battery is lying on the floor over there. I'm connecting battery positive to one end of this filament bulb and battery negative to the second end of the filament bulb. Right, so let me, you can see the bulb glow, right? The orange glow. I want you to, we are going off topic, but for a second, why are all these lights always in orange or white? Why can't we have a blue light? Okay, blue light bulbs, why can't we have it? Just think about it. We can talk about it later. That particular question came in mind in one of the researchers or scientists in 1900s. And because of that particular question, the entire quantum mechanics, the concept of photons, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, everything related to quantum mechanics came from that single question. Okay. I know I went away from the topic, but let me explain that particular question once again. What happened was, maybe your generation and neither my generation, but my father's generation, they had these amazing cycles with dynamos fixed to them. So when they ride those cycles and these dynamos, the energy from the dynamos is connected to actually a bulb that's fixed to the front of the cycles. Okay, I hope you got the point. So what they do is at nights, you need to see something around when you want to ride, right? So the faster they ride, the bulb glows more brightly. And because of that, you can see what's happening in front of you. So those dynamos were helpful in that particular way. So in around 1900s, people saw such dynamos, such cycles and all. And one of the scientists got an idea. However fast I tried to turn the wheel with the pedals and all that, why am I not able to generate other colors? You know, VibGYOR, right? VibGYOR. Okay, red is easiest to get actually. You see, you just saw the orange color light from the bulb. Why can't I get other colors? Why is it very hard for me to get yellow color or green or blue color light or violet light? That was the question that arose. and from there it exploded, and whatever technology that we are seeing related to electromagnetism and all, it's because of that. When I say electromagnetism, it all depends on electrons. When I say electrons, it has to do with quantum mechanics, your atomic structure chapter in your textbook. So all that happened with that simple question. So observation is crucial, guys. When you observe something, I want you to ask questions, not just in my class, but any class actually. And LEDs are a little different actually. I just got a thing from Amrit saying, white LEDs are blue because of the phosphorus coating. Yes, with LEDs, it is possible to get other colored lights. It's very easy, in fact. But with these traditional filament bulbs, it's impossible to obtain that light, actually. Okay? All we have is a tiny tungsten spring inside, tungsten filament inside. And just because of supplying this electrical energy, it's glowing. You supply more energy, you might see a little bit of whiteness. Maybe from orange, you might see a little bit of white, but never the blue color. So I want you to think about this. Maybe in one of the sessions, we can talk about those also. Okay. Now, the reason I did that experiment was I wanted to ask few questions. So what is the purpose of battery in that circuit? What was battery's job in that circuit? I want you to write it, or you can even speak. You can... just turn off the, you can turn on your mic and speak out if you want, or you can just type in chat window. My first question, what is the purpose of this battery in that particular circuit? Guys, girls, you have been answering much more complicated ones. There is no trick thing in this. It's a straightforward question. What is the purpose? What is it doing there? Exactly. Amana just answered. It's too simple. So that's the reason I think you got, you might have thought I'm having a tricky question. Battery supplies energy. I mean, you're being very specific, like current and electricity. I'm speaking a little generally. Everything is correct, guys. So battery is the energy supplier in that particular circuit. Okay. Next. What is the job of this bulb? What is this bulb doing? Now you got the sense, I guess. I'm talking everything in terms of energy. I hope you can also answer in terms of energy. The purpose of this battery is to supply energy. What is the bulb doing? What is the purpose of that bulb? Anyone? So I have Hamsika for the previous answer, but right now Harshini, electrical energy to light energy, consuming energy, very good answers. Bulb converts electrical energy to light energy and heat energy. Good job, guys. Okay, yeah, perfect. So battery is supplying the energy, bulb is consuming the energy, and on top of that, the bonus thing it is doing is it's actually converting that electrical energy into light energy and also heat energy. With LEDs, you don't see much heat, but the traditional filament bulbs, even heat energy is a lot. That's actually a lot of wastage too. Okay, so you actually got two things, purpose of battery and purpose of the bulb. Now tell me the purpose of these connecting wires. I had these two wires, two connecting wires. What was the purpose of those wires? Again, in terms of energy. Exactly, Amrit already answered. I'm getting direct messages. You can also put it as a general message so that others can see, guys. Okay, Rishikesh, supply of energy. Amrit, transfer of energy. Supporters in terms of transferring energy. So everything has a purpose in a circuit. Battery to supply energy, bulb to consume energy and convert energy, that's the next step, and the wires to transfer energy. All right, so that's the thing. Now, if you have a switch in the circuit, what do you think switch job is? What is the purpose of a switch? Switch is like a toll gate, right? You pay the money, only then you pass through that road. Otherwise, you get blocked. So switch is like barricade. Either it allows energy to pass through or stops the energy. Yeah, regulation is much more generic term. I just had Amrit answering regulates. That's wonderful answer, Amrit. That's true, actually. Regulation means not only stopping, but even slowing down or reducing. But in case of a typical switch, you can't stop. I mean, you can't reduce, only stop. But if you use a resistor, you can actually reduce the energy. Okay. Yeah. Anyway, we'll move on from that particular thing. But amazing answers, guys. I want everyone to try it out. Okay. So don't worry about what others would think if you give a wrong answer. Never compare with others. You always have to compare with yourself. Are you improving or not? Should be the only question. Don't care about what others would think as long as you're doing a good thing. Okay. If you're doing a bad thing, it's all total different philosophy, by the way. All right. So we spoke about that simple circuit. Now I want to ask you one thing. The ends of this particular wire, they're actually made with steel. I know if it would be copper, it's much more beneficial. But anyway, let's talk about this wire. Inside this plastic coating, what do you think is inside? Is it metal or is it non-metal, like plastic or rubber? What do you think it is inside this wire?
Metal.
Exactly. That's a strong answer from everyone. I'm getting huge loads and loads of answers. Everyone has a common thing, metal. So my question is, why can't you use a non-metal? I have some specific answers also. Shankar just gave me copper. Good job. Yeah, it's in fact copper. Some of you already knew that, but you were all trying to be more general. Yeah, it's copper actually. These are all copper wires. With corners, I have these. By the way, these are called crocodile clips for obvious reason. So it's like crocodile clip. In US, they actually call them alligator clips. They don't have many crocodiles. They have something called alligators. One of other species of crocodiles, I think. You can call relatives of crocodiles. Maybe they're called alligators. They're called alligator clips over there. Here we call them crocodile clips. They're made with steel, by the way. Yeah, I got answer from Harshita and Mrudula. Non-metals are bad conductors of electricity. Non-metals do not transport electricity. Wonderful answers, but I'm asking you the reason. Let me modify my question again. Why can't non-metals supply energy? Why can't they transfer the electrical energy? We all know that non-metals cannot do it, but I'm asking you why. This is called critical thinking, guys. Critical thinking, essentially, it differs from normal thinking. We're asking more and more questions, but asking questions that are actually focused on one particular direction. I mean, if you ask questions pertaining to a single direction, you call it critical thinking. If you just randomly ask questions, it's normal thinking. Okay, so my question was, why non-metals cannot conduct electricity? I have an answer from Amrit. What he has is no free electrons. Wonderful. We are closing this particular topic. No free electrons. And a similar answer from Rishikesh. Electrons will not move. Both are very similar, right? No free electrons. Free electron means freely movable electrons. Now, so metals have freely moving electrons in their structures. Non-metals do not have freely moving electrons in their structures. So my next question is, why non-metals do not have free moving electrons and why metals have free moving electrons? That's my next question. I hope you got it. Try to remember where we started this topic. Now I'm asking you to focus on one last thing. We got the concept. Free electrons is the most important thing when it comes to either electricity or even heat. Even for transfer of heat, free electrons help a lot. Even for reflection of light, light reflects from a mirror surface because there's a silver coating on the back of it, and silver coating has a lot of free electrons that helps in reflection of light. Okay, now we are focusing on this free electrons. What makes metals so special, or what makes non-metals so bad that they don't have free electrons, and why metals have free electrons? Amarnath, is it share? I just got an answer from Arnav. I think no attraction from Rishikesh. Let me repeat one more time. Why metals have free electrons? Why non-metals do not have free electrons? Exactly. We are going microscopic now. I got one of the answers from Amrit. It says, because of the valency. True. Exactly true. Metals are electropositive substances, non-metals are electronegative substances. Exactly, yeah. I think you all have that sense in your mind. Let's speak about one thing. I'm not observing chat window for a few seconds, guys. Let's move on to this topic. All right. So I'll add a new slide, an empty thing. Okay. So tell me what is, you don't have to tell me, I'm not going to look at chat, right? So sodium atomic number is 11, right? Sodium atomic number is 11. Atomic number 11 means protons are 11. What about electrons? How many electrons does sodium have?
11.
Exactly. Electrons are 11. But you are all supposed to ask me one more question. Is it sodium metal or sodium ion or whatever it is? Okay. So the thing is, for a neutral sodium element or neutral sodium metal, the atomic number is 11, that means 11 protons. Since it's neutral, electrons should also be 11. Okay. So now, when you talk about a very simple structure for sodium, I'm just drawing. Imagine that's the nucleus. Nucleus has that 11 protons and neutrons in there. And let's build, I'm actually showing you something similar to Bohr's atomic model, circular shells for now. Excuse me, I'm not drawing this quantum model. It's extremely tough. Now, 11. How many does the first shell have? How many electrons does the first shell? Guys, use your mic and do that. Yes, exactly. Exactly, that's two. I'm going to use green color for electrons. So that's the first electron. Let's say 1s1, 1s2. Okay, that's the first two electrons in the first shell. Now, how many does the second shell have?
Eight.
Yes, the formula is 2m square, right? 2 into 2 square. 2 into 2 square is the 2 fours are 8. So let's have those 8 electrons. I know you already know the answers, but I'm actually trying to establish what is specialty about the metals. So I have 4 electrons already there. Yeah. And I have 8 right now. So the total number of electrons in the first two shells are 10, right? So 1s2, 2s2, and 2p6. Now, sodium has the 11th electron. So what we need to do is we need to consider the third shell. Shells are always there. We only use whatever we want, and that's a very horrible shell. Yeah. And the last electron, which we call the free electron, is over here, for example. So we call it free electron because it is away from the influence of this nucleus. Definitely, nucleus has some influence, but most of the focus is laid by the inner electrons, the inside shell electrons. They are actually having all the focus, but the outer one, it can actually roam around. If you take a typical sodium metal block, let's imagine this is a sodium metal block. This sodium metal block, you can imagine that it has this sodium plus ion. Let's say one of them is sodium plus ion. That means sodium plus means it has only 10 electrons and one electron is free to roam around. So it can travel anywhere in that sodium metal block. But those sodium ions, the main sodium, I mean, when I say sodium ions, I'm talking about the nucleus, the first shell and second shell electrons. Until this point is the sodium ion. That particular free electron is this last electron. So it is free to roam around. So metals have this tendency of giving away electrons. Now think about fluorine, guys. What about fluorine? Fluorine atomic number is 9. A neutral fluorine atom has 9 electrons. So when it comes to fluorine, you in fact, this is the problem. Okay, fluorine has 9 electrons. In fact, it will actually be happy if it could get an electron from somewhere else. It's already deprived of an electron. One electron is not available for it to be stable. If it could get one electron from somewhere, it will be very, very happy. It will give a big thankful note actually to you. So non-metals generally do not conduct electricity because this is the reason. Non-metals, they're not ready to give electrons. They're already suffering because of lack of electrons. And there's no way they would give electrons. And only free electrons can move around, resulting the electricity or supply of electricity or transfer of electricity. That is the foundation. The reason I brought the topic from the experiment till this point is so that you can understand how it is all linked up. Okay. And most important conclusion from all this discussion is simple. If you want electricity, or if you want to transfer electricity, metals are the good choice. And this understanding is important because later on when we perform the experiment related to temperature, like what happens when temperature is increased in a metal wire? Will it become a good conductor or a bad conductor? This concept will be required for us. We that's the reason I went a little on board and spend a lot of time on this particular thing. Okay. I have 3 chat messages. Let me check. Okay, nothing required to be addressed right now. I just had answers related to number of electrons. Okay, now let's move on. I mean, that was the first experiment in your textbook. We spoke about a lot of things about energy suppliers, energy consumers, and the wires being the energy transferers, and reasons for using metals and not non-metals. Okay, all these are important. And moreover, in non-metals, all are covalently bonded. Covalent bonds, it's very, very hard to break. Only when you break, then you might have free electrons, a small possibility of free electrons. So covalent bonds, it's extremely hard to break. That's also the reason, okay? Now, Drude and Lorentz theory. This is again part of the textbook, guys. Whenever I say something outside the textbook, I'll mention it, okay? Now you can see a metal wire. In this, all the free electrons, just like sodium is able to donate 1 electron, aluminum can donate 3 electrons, magnesium can donate 2 electrons, okay? So this is like a community of sodium metal, for example. All sodium atoms are there inside, and each atom is contributing 1 electron. Just like South Korea, in South Korea, every family should send 1 person to the army. Every family, no exceptions. You're rich, you're poor, doesn't matter. You have to send 1 person to the army. I think only exception could be health issues, severe health issues. So something like that. So to this community, each metallic atom is contributing an electron over here. Okay. So those electrons, what Drude and Lorentz theory tells us is, those electrons generally move randomly. There is no organized movement. Each electron moves in different directions. And that's what you're seeing over here. There's no real pattern anyway, okay? And the reason for this random movement is this actually. Electron is a negatively charged particle. There's another electron that's negatively charged particle, and there's always repulsions between them. And they also collide with the sodium metal or the metals. You have these metals. You have metals atoms everywhere. So let me show this, okay? Now imagine there is an electron that's traveling. One electron, let's say again, I have it, this green one. It's trying to travel towards a particular metal surface. And there are all these outside electrons, all these outer electrons which are already existing over here. And those outer electrons would actually create a little bit of obstruction. So there are multiple reasons for metals not traveling. Now, the multiple reasons for why these electrons move randomly. One reason is the repulsions between the electrons, and another thing is collisions with the lattice structure. Lattice structure, we'll speak about it in a few seconds. And also energy of the boundaries. This boundary surfaces also has a lot of energy. Because of that energy also, there's a lot of repulsions everywhere. Okay, so obviously, because of all this mass confusion inside, electrons cannot travel very fast. And the energy of those electrons, I mean, how fast the electrons can move depends on 2 factors. One is the electron's kinetic energy, and another one is the lattice energy. Lattice energy is the vibrational energy, guys. What it means is, imagine, now if you see over here, I have a chat window active. I'll see that, but first I want to speak about this. Now, please ignore the bottom one. We'll speak about the bottom one a little later. But right now, see this particular structure. In this structure, these orange ones are the metallic ions. These orange ones, actually, each orange one, imagine, donated 1 electron. The small blue color ones are the electrons. Okay, now it's a little close-up thing. Okay, now the orange ones are the metallic ions. And when they were in atomic state, they actually donated an electron. Blue color one is the electron. Now, if you observe, this only observe these orange colored ones, guys. Only the orange colored. You can see this neat organization. Everything is organized, equal gaps between orange ones. There's an equal gaps on the vertical direction, equal gaps on the horizontal, equal on the diagonal direction too. All these are perfectly organized. Such organizing is called a lattice structure. So in order for these electrons to move, these lattice structures are one obstacle. Now, in the previous slide, you saw something. You saw something called lattice energy, vibrational energy. What this vibrational energy means is, right now it is at room temperature. Let's say that the temperature of the room is like somewhere between 23 and 30. Because of that temperature, these particular metallic atoms or metallic ions, they are in a state of such vibration. They move back and forth, top and bottom. They cannot move freely like electrons, but they can vibrate around their mean position. This is the mean position, and about the mean position, they can vibrate. So when they are vibrating, these electrons get obstructed. Okay? Imagine if the temperature is increased. When the temperature increases, the vibrations will increase and electrons will be obstructed further. So when I say the movement of these electrons depends on two things. One is the kinetic energy of the electrons. That means how much energy that particular thing has, kinetic energy, the movement energy. Second thing is the vibrations of these lattice structures. So it depends on these two factors. So now you might have a question. What if I decrease the temperature? With high temperature, the vibrations are more. With temperature, when it is reduced, let's imagine I take the temperature of the metal block to minus 200 degrees. When I take the temperature to minus 200 degrees, almost this particular ion, it almost stops its vibration. It's impossible to stop, but it almost stops. Previously, it was vibrating vigorously. At minus 200, maybe it vibrates a very tiny bit. And that state is called superconductivity state. At that particular state, electrons can move very freely and there is no energy wastage. Okay. I hope you are understanding these points. We are outside our actual syllabus, but these are helpful, guys. Now, I'm bringing this point because one of the reasons our energy market or energy manufacturers are facing severe losses is right from the power station till our homes, electricity should pass through all those thousands and thousands of miles of wires. And when they travel, a lot of heat will be generated. When heat generates, these metal ions inside the wires, they start to vibrate vigorously. When they vibrate, the electrons slow down. So all this is a problem. So because of that heating, even I'm using a laptop, it has become very, very hot right now. Because of the heated state, the energy cannot be supplied easily. A lot of energy wastages are happening. Okay. So the main problem in all this is heat. If you could minimize heating of the wires, then you can save a lot of energy. And I think there's one research group in Singapore that they're actively working towards this. Even at room temperature, they're trying to minimize those vibrations of this lattice structure. So if they are successful, it will be a huge boost to the market. We can save a lot of energy. And those guys are definite shortlist for the next Nobel Prize, actually. Okay. So you might be wondering that I went too much off topic, but all these will come back in our topic, actually. And don't think about topic or not topic. You're smart enough and you know what to prepare for your exams. But keep an open mind to understand whatever I'm saying. And as I told, it's whatever you're investing right now in time, the investment that you're doing in time right now, it will help you in the future if you're going in the science space. So that's the reason, guys. All right, let me look at the chat window and we'll move on. Yes, exactly. The energy I have again from Amrit. Energy due to temperature. Exactly. I mean, you say resistance. What is resistance and all we'll speak about. Whenever heat of the metal block increases, its resistance increases. When resistance, what resistance means over here is all these obstructions like the lattice vibrations and many more actually. So we'll go in depth in all of these topics. Yeah, we have around half an hour, guys. So let's move on. And someone did a lot of artistic work on my slide. I really don't know how to erase or if I have that ability to erase. Whoever did that artistic work, kindly please erase it because it will be carried to other slides also. That's the reason. Yeah, you can see that, right? Even the other slides have this. Guys, anyone, girls, whoever has tried it, see if you could erase it on your window. I think there's an option to erase the whole thing. Please check it out. All right, anyway, so I have new artwork. I really don't mind. I mean, I train my mind to work even in distractions, but not everyone is capable of that. So please try to do your best to erase that off. But I'm going ahead with our topic. Now, absence of electric field, this is what I wrote. So whatever Drude and Lorentz theory that we have discussed till now, the random movement of electrons and all that, it only happens in the absence of electric field. Whenever you see the word electric field, it means it's connected to a battery or not connected to a battery. When you connect a metallic wire, the wire that we tried out a little while back, when you connect it to a battery, then electric field will be established in this wire. We'll go in depth about this particular concept. But when there is no battery connection, there is no electric field. Or in simpler words, what you can think is electric field will push the electrons to make them a little organized. Electric field will make the electrons in an organized fashion. And without electric field, there is no organizing. Now, imagine like your classroom. When there's no teacher in your classroom, you're really disorganized. You do whatever crap you want, right? No one is there to check or punish you. But when a teacher enters, there's a good possibility you maintain that discipline, you stay at your seats, something like that. So the teacher role or the battery role is very similar over here. Okay? Now, we spoke in detail about what happens when there is no electric field. Completely random motion. This is an exaggerated image, guys. But when there is an electric field, that means when you connect it to a battery, there is an acceleration, or essentially there is an organized motion. Here, as I told you, it's an exaggeration. Really, they're not that organized like military forces, like Roman military, one standing behind the other. It's a little bit of random, but there is a direction. Direction in the sense, there is a goal-oriented approach. Here, electrons, they're moving randomly. There is no real goal or anything. Here, there might be a little random movement of that blue color small marbles or blue color circles that you're seeing. Little random thing will be there, but ultimately they'll move in from left to right. So they might start at left and they move towards the right direction. Okay, so there is a movement. So since there is a movement, there's already an acceleration. Here, we generally don't talk about acceleration because a lot of cancelling effects are happening over there. Okay, so no electric field. Let me summarize this slide. Random movement, electric field, or with a battery, there will be an electron acceleration and there will also be a little bit of organized movement. So before I move on, I want to check back on this chat window. Yeah, I think I have a message related to those chart, the artistic work that you have done, but anyway, it's solved, resolved. So before we move on to this topic, whatever electricity is, or whatever we talk about electric current, potential difference, electromotive force, they're all extremely simple topics, guys. When you think in terms of electrons, they're very simple. When you complicate it with other factors, it might be a little disturbed. But let's look at in terms of electrons. Whenever you think about electron, if you think of them as understanding how the electrons are moving, how many electrons are moving, or how fast they are moving, all that corresponds to the concept of electric current. Once again, please listen. Whenever you hear the word electric current, it talks about how many electrons are moving and how fast or how slow they are moving. That's what is electric current. Entire electronics, you have electrical engineering, electronics engineering, all those. Everything is the study of electrons, nothing more, nothing less. Even electromagnetism, to a certain degree, is the study of electrons. So all we are doing right now is we are studying these electrons. Whenever we talk about resistance, electric resistance, we are trying to understand what is the reason for slow movement of electrons. Why in some metals, electron moves fast? Why in some metals, electrons move slowly? So this is what is electrical resistance. Now, when you talk about potential difference and electromotive force, we talk about reasons why electrons move in an organized pattern. So you saw here, right? Here there is no EMF or no potential difference. But here in this wire, there's definite EMF and definite potential difference. So it talks about energy. How are the electrons able to move in an organized fashion? Who is responsible for that? It's the battery where EMF comes in. It's a potential difference. All those things comes into picture. So I want you to simplify your mind, simplify your thought process. Entire chapter talks about electrons, how they are moving, why they are stopping, who is pushing them, who is stopping them. Okay? Right. It's 3:48, guys. I'm getting messages asking me to stop. We can't stop abruptly. I know, but it has been a very heavy class. Lots of discussions. The other classes will be much more smooth because we'll be doing experiments also. I can't stop about the topic right now, but our discussion can be stopped. Rather, let's not do it till 4:15. We'll stop it at 4. This is the first time you are meeting me. It will take a little bit of time to get adjusted. And I also told you, my goal here is to not complete the syllabus that was planned. My goal here is to make sure that you understand most of it. And my goal is also to make you think a lot. So keeping that in mind, I don't want to trouble you, but I still want to continue till 4:00. I'll not talk about this slide, guys. I want to just talk with you, general talking, okay? Now, you can turn on your mics whenever you want to speak. I don't want to talk about the topic, by the way, electricity. I want to talk about general, how you are feeling and all. Okay, I want to talk about, are you following COVID precautions? Yeah, tell me, did you relax completely? Are you still using soap, maintaining social distance? Anyone? Are you still checking COVID-related updates, right? Now you have a strain in UK that's much more deadly, much more faster. But you don't have to take special precautions. All you have to do is the same thing. Wear a mask compulsorily, the 6 feet distance and all those, you still have to continue, guys. I know many of you would be playing cricket or you'll be meeting friends regularly. So try your best, because you might be wondering, you don't have COVID, they don't have COVID, it's okay to meet and all, but at least I know you need to meet. We are social animals, we need this kind of interaction. But even when you meet your friends, wear that mask, and as soon as you disperse, wash your hands or use a sanitizer and try your best during that interaction. Try not to touch your faces and all. Okay. So wear a mask even while playing, guys. Okay. And that's what I wanted to speak. I mean, whenever I get a chance. So be careful about COVID. It's not just about you. You might be carrying that particular disease to your family, and that's more disastrous. Okay. Just remember about your parents, your grandparents, and all those also. So I want to talk about your classes. Tell me about electromagnetism. Was the topic covered? Anyone?
No, sir. Started.
Okay. Just started. I thought that is not part of your exam syllabus, right? Is it? Guys, is it part of your exam syllabus?
No, sir.
Okay, so anyway, so I think after you guys complete electromagnetism theory, then we will do experiments. Those are one of the amazing experiments you could ever see, actually. So I wanted to talk about that. What about atomic structure? Are you done with atomic structure topic?
Yes,
sir.
So did you understand the concepts of principal quantum number, angular momentum quantum number, all those?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I have still some time. I mean, I have 9 more minutes. Even if you scold me, I want to spend some time. I want to show you one of my new apparatus. I built that apparatus recently. I want to show it to you. This discussion is not planned, obviously. Suddenly, I came up with this. So I'll bring that apparatus. Give me a minute. It's in the other room. And by the way, right now, we are in my video room. You can see this green sheet. So when I make videos, I stay here actually. And there are multiple lights over here. Let me show you. central stand is actually for my phone. When I use my phone as the video supported, I'm right now using laptop. So I actually make all these myself. Those poles that you see with the lights, I prepared them myself. The phone stand, I prepared them myself. It's very, very easy if you could involve. I mean, it's all basic materials available at the house, at your homes, any general shops, you can actually get it actually. All you need to do is try to experiment it, a few precautions while you do it actually. All right, so I'm going ahead and I'll bring that atomic structure model that I've prepared. I want to show for a few seconds to you and then we'll close it off today. But next time, I want you to actually train yourself. I will sit for 2 hours and I'll try my best to not get distracted from the daily routine. I don't want to think about anything else actually. That's what you need to train your mind. With the smartphone thing, there's a problem of attention span. You can't maintain attention for a long time. So that's the problem with smartphones, but there are a lot of advantages with smartphones too. The advantage is right now clear. Whatever I'm speaking, you're able to listen to me even at this many kilometers of distance. So it's an amazing thing with smartphones, but you should also be able to control yourself and resist yourself while using all these technologies, guys. Good and bad. Like just every person has good and bad. Some of you might not like Gandhiji because of some bad things he might have done, but he did a lot of good things. Pick good from everywhere, push away the bad thing, make sure you don't do those bad things by yourself, okay? Anyway, give me a minute, I'll bring that atomic structure. We'll spend exactly 5 minutes and we'll call it off. All right, I'll be holding this. I hope you can see this model. So it's quite colorful, as you can see. The reason I made this like this, I mean, I would not say it's an exact model because no one knows how an electron is or how an atom is inside it, actually. So it's all based on theories, guys. The theories, as you know, it started out with Thomson's model, then Rutherford. I mean, even before Thomson, you had Dalton's model. Rutherford gave his model. Like, it has been progressions. You had Bohr's model, Sommerfeld modified it a little bit. And then you have a quantum mechanical model, which is supposed to be the perfect model, but there is no proof for it till now. There's no proof that quantum mechanical model is correct. But my purpose over here, I made it in this particular way, so that your 10th class syllabus can be covered. So what I mean is, this is the first shell. If you observe, this is the first shell and I made it as white color. So white correspond to S subshell. You know SP, DF, right? 1S2, 2S2, S. White correspond to S subshell. Now this is the second shell. In the second shell, you have two subshells. One is S subshell and one is P subshell. White is 2S, orange is 2P. When you go to the third shell, number of subshells will be 3, S, P, and D. White is S, orange is P, and blue is D. So 3S, 3P, 3D. And this is that Moeller's diagram. And overall, I have over here, and by the way, look at this. I have a periodic table also on this side, which you could refer. And all in all, what I have here is 118 magnets. I have each and every hole over here in this cap. There's a magnet over here. The reason I placed a magnet over here is that to 118. The reason it's 118 because we have 118 elements till now. That's what is discovered till now. So each magnet is for representing elements. And what I do is I give metal balls and you just have to fill electrons in this. Maybe one of our other days when you feel like electricity topic is too heavy, let's get distracted. We can do that. I'll show how to use this particular one. But I hope you got the purpose of this. So it talks about shells. It talks about shells, subshells. It also talks about all the three most important rules, like the Hund's rule. There is this Hund's rule over here. You also might be using Hund, H-U-N-D, Hund's rule. Abbas principle, Pauli's principle, Pauli's. All those principles can be explained with this particular model. I would not say that this is the model really that's happening inside an atom, but at least this particular model will help you with understanding 10th syllabus in much more detail. That's my interest, guys. Whatever I do, I try to simplify them with apparatus. And in order to understand these amazing theories, you actually have to try it out. And when you try it out, you create some wonderful things in the process. And you also create some crap things also in the process, actually. All right. So with that, we're almost done. 3:58. Anyone, before we close, you want to talk something? You can actually speak it out, guys, openly. I'm very good with handling criticism also. You don't like something from me, you just have to say, I'll take it very positively. And I'll also try my best to change myself. It's like, I'm a combination of even, I like philosophy a lot. Right now, I joined psychology course, Dr. Ambedkar University distance course. I joined psychology. I really like psychology too. So what I'm trying to say, I'm a very positive person. Don't hesitate. Just openly say, you don't like something, I can change myself for that. Anyone with any inputs? Any modifications for our next class? I hope I slowed down a little bit. During the other time when I got a message saying that you are very fast, I slowed it down, hopefully. If you want me to slow down further, I can do that. I know you want to leave, but I just want someone to speak out anything before we close. No outputs? Okay. Sir, Amir sir, are you available?
Yeah, yeah, yes, sir. Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah. I am available.
Sir, please go on.
Sir, tomorrow, did you inform them, sir?
Not yet.
What is the time tomorrow? 10
I'm
o'clock.
I'm about to inform. We can have it between 10 to 12, sir. I have a okay. couple of meetings after that, actually. So we can have it 10 to 12 tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Definitely. Thank you, sir. A great history. And the children are very exciting, sir. Actually, they don't know. Generally, whatever it is, class is going on, directly the topic will start the teachers in generally.
Right.
But this much of history is very essential. Why? Because to know the basic idea, why the electricity is produced, what is the basic concept, how they developed the scientists, all the things. So it's a great, extraordinary one, sir. They pay attention also. Our children are extraordinary, no doubt it also.
Sir.
So tomorrow onwards, we are having practicals, no, sir? Completely?
We have still some theory, sir, and then we'll move on to the practicals. I was also thinking, we actually went in very great detail, sir. So our initial plan of 6 hours might not be enough. I told...
Okay, sir, as you said, our children is ready to... Ready.
Okay.
Our children, as much as you... They are ready to paying attention, sir. They know, they want to learn the more concepts, sir.
Okay.
Already they are having that much of a... patience, right? Because 6th to 7th onwards, they are very much interest.
Wonderful, sir.
You finished the MS in which university, sir, in that America?
It's called Texas A&M University, sir.
Yeah. A&M. Sir, thanks a lot, sir, okay, from behalf of our children. Say thank you, better. How to say?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
No problem.
Thank you, sir.
Let's meet tomorrow. Sir, we are ready
for tomorrow, sir.
Definitely. Bye-bye. Okay.
Thank you. Bye. See you.